Gita 11th chapter we are discussing. In the previous talk, we finished our talk with verse number 8, where Lord Krishna tells Arjuna that you will not be able to see my cosmic form with the physical eyes that you have, and so I am giving you the spiritual insight. And we mentioned how Sri Ramakrishna had given that spiritual insight to Narendranath, and Narendranath had some of those cosmic visions. And Sanjay then says, Ev muktva tato rajan maha yogeshwaro hari darshayamas parthaya paramam rupamaisharam. And then Lord Krishna touched, or by his mere will, he gave the power to Arjuna by which he could see the cosmic form of Lord Krishna. Now here, before we continue with verse number 10, where the famous cosmic form of the Lord is described, there are one or two things that we should know. The most important thing being, as we proceed with this description, some of you who might have seen the pictures of the cosmic form, many people have painted based on the description that is going to follow here. We have to keep in mind that for the Hindus, Vedanta is the ultimate truth. And according to Vedanta, the pure conscious principle is in every living being. Actually, it is in everything. When we were discussing chapter 10, there also it was mentioned that initially it was told that every living being has it, and then it was told that everything is manifestation of the Lord. Now when you're seeing that cosmic form, you're seeing all those things together as the divine, but not in the physical form, but at the subtle level. And for persons like us, it's slightly difficult to understand what exactly they mean by the subtle form. Those of you who might have read the Gospel of Sri Ramakrishna, there you'll find Sri Ramakrishna talking about many of his spiritual experiences which relate directly to the sukshma jagat, the subtle world. Swamiji doesn't describe much, and the other descriptions that we find here and there is slightly difficult to believe whether they are really true or not. Now here in this Gita, the kind of description that we get here, we find this kind of description partly in the Puranas also. And because Sri Ramakrishna has also seen something, not once, he used to see different kind of visions regularly. Whenever his mind went into that higher state, you can say altered state of consciousness. Now one very interesting thing about this thing is that it's not personal God that is being described. Every time we talk about personal God, whenever people talk about God, they think of God as a person, as someone. For example, the general picture that we see in Hindu households, say of Vinayak, Ganesh, we see of say Lord Vishnu or Krishna, we see there is a person, and there is a person, and he has been painted or picturized in some form, and that's worshipped. From there we get this idea that God is something like a person. He is like one of us, just that his powers, etc., is manifold more, infinitely more. If you keep an eye on the verses that are going to follow, you'll say, no, that's not the description. The description is of the infinite, and infinite means infinite. So there is no one head, there is no one stomach, there is no one single mouth, there are not just two arms. Now when you hear of Lord Vishnu having four arms, it does not mean that Lord Vishnu has four arms. It's just to give an idea that he is not just like any one of us. When you read things about say Lord Shiva or many, many other stories, it is to give you an idea that he is not like any one of us. Unfortunately, when we want to meditate, when we want to describe, we like to describe God as a person, as someone who has infinitely more power, but essentially he is like us. The fact is not that. The fact is that he is the Lord. And he has infinite forms. And it, in one single form, all that infinity is embedded. So that has to be kept in mind. And secondly, although this 11th chapter is highly commended for its poetry and its beauty, its poetry is beautiful, this should not be taken as literal truth. Shouldn't imagine that this is the literal truth. When a person sees this cosmic form, he will see something like that. But then no two persons will ever have the same kind of vision. So the vision that you have here in Gita, this will not be repeated in Bhagavatam. And what Gita and Bhagavatam talk, that will not be repeated by Sri Ramakrishna. And what these three say will not be repeated with you. So when you are meditating and if you think that you are going to have a vision like this, something like, you know, for example, you are traveling from Howrah to Delhi and you are going by, say, Rajdhani Express. And there are two popular routes. One is via Gaya and Dhanbad, and there is via Patna and all. So when you are traveling to Delhi, if you go to Patna, everyone will see Patna station practically in the same way. So naturally you think that when you are doing spiritual practices, when you are growing spiritually, you will have the same kind of vision that's described here. No, you will not. Those of you who might have studied something in nuclear physics, there they talk about if a particle is moving from one point to another, there are infinite number of possibilities, infinite path. And the probability of all that, when summed up, becomes the path that is. It's a very interesting thing. Particularly when it goes to subatomic physics, they talk like that. And most things we really don't understand. When it comes to spirituality, it literally goes like that. Literally, there are infinite paths. And those infinite paths, that is innumerable. Innumerable, infinite means just infinite. And ultimately it leads to complete annihilation of the personality. Your individuality is completely finished. That's the only truth. What exactly happens after that, nobody knows. What we know is that you become one with the divine. That's the ultimate truth. So these things should not be taken literally because of more than one reasons. So the visions that Sri Ramakrishna had, it is not necessary that anyone else will have. You may have, you may not have. That is one thing to be understood. And that's why, you know, these monotheistic religion people, when they keep on talking about God and path and this and that, somehow they, although they are talking about the infinite, they just don't understand what infinity means. They don't understand what infinity means in the physical world, nor they understand what infinity means in the spiritual world. So verse number 10 begins with that. Anek vaktra nayanam, anek adbhuta darshanam, anek divyabharanam, divya aneko dyutayudham. See, when the Lord expressed his cosmic form, what Arjuna saw was overwhelming. Arjuna is overwhelmed. Why? He sees that there is that Lord who has many faces, many mouths, many heads. In fact, infinite number of heads. Why? Every head is his head. My head is his head. Your head is his head. So how many heads the Lord has? Infinite number of heads. The heads that are there present on this universe, and the heads that they are to come. All the heads are the Lord's head. And all the eyes are his eyes. All the ears are his eyes. He is seeing the Lord in that form. And not only that, says, the sight is overwhelming. Seeing strange things that Arjuna has never seen. And he has infinite number of hands, and in each hand he carries a divine weapon, the kind of weapon that has never been seen. And his body is decked with divine jewelry. So, the moment this cosmic form, description of the cosmic form begins, the first introduction is of the infinity, second introduction is of the divinity. Infinity and divinity, you know, these two characteristics define God. He is infinite in every sense, and he is divine in every sense. So the weapons that he is going to use are divine. The cloth, etc., that he uses is divine. Now, the jewelry that he is putting on is divine. Everything is divine. Divya malyam varadharam divya gandhanulepanam sarvashirimayam devam anantam vishvatomukam. The Lord, he has infinite faces. Everywhere is his face. If you chance to read the Upanishads and some of the mantras in the Vedas, the famous mantra is Sahasra Shirsa Purusha, that Purushuktam, when it begins with. The Lord has 1,000 heads. By 1,000 heads, they mean infinite number of heads, because every head is his head. That same idea is being repeated here. So it says, he has put on the garlands which are divine. And his body is fragrant. In earlier times, people used to put on sandal paste, etc. So what the Lord has put on is just divine. So, and his cloth, they are also divine. And whatever he is seeing, just amazing, overwhelming. This is basically the idea of Advaita, where according to Advaita, Atman alone exists. So whatever you see is a manifestation of Atman. Whatever is there in the universe is the face of the Lord. And when you're looking at the Lord, whatever he has is all divine. Now verse number 12 says, how he really looks. Divi Surya Sahasrasya Bhavet Yug Paduttita Yadi Bhasadrishi Sasyad Bhasastasya Mahatmana. If you can imagine that in space, 1,000 suns have suddenly risen simultaneously. Not one, 1,000 suns. That kind of brilliance was there. And in fact, says that even that brilliance may not be able to match the brilliance that God carried about him at that moment. You know, you might remember, some of you might be knowing, the very famous episode that when atomic bomb project was going on, Robert Oppenheimer, he was the chief of that project, he was the chief scientist of that project, Manhattan Project. Oppenheimer knew many languages, and he was really a very, very, very talented person, extremely talented person. And he knew Sanskrit, that's a very surprising thing, and he knew Gita. And we really don't know how much he knew of Sanskrit, and because scientists are divided divided on the opinion that he knew Sanskrit. But one thing is true, that when that atomic bomb exploded in the Manhattan Project, he spoke out aloud this verse, Devi Surya Sahasrasya Bhavet Yuga Paduttita. There's a very famous thing. So he chanted it out, Robert Oppenheimer. And I was reading another scientist, he narrated something different from the same chapter. Kaloham loka kshay krita praviddho, I am death. So that these two verses, first is about the brightness, second one is about death. And in both the cases is the cosmic form. There's a cosmic brilliance and there is that cosmic death. So Oppenheimer, very famously, and that of course everyone says, because many were present, top scientists were present, And the moment he saw, they were expecting, they knew that brilliance will be something like that. And he spoke out aloud this particular verse. Divi Surya Sahasrasya Bhavet Yuga Paduthita Yadi Bhasadrishi Sa. Even the thousand suns may or may not equal the brilliance of the Lord that was there. So first you find the infinite form, then you find the divine form, and now you see the brilliance form. And it's now slowly coming down to more mundane level. Here we find the unity in diversity. There are different things, different descriptions are there, and through all those descriptions there is one conscious principle which is running through all those things. Those of you who have been listening to these talks on Gita very sincerely, and those of you who have some idea about the facts as described in the Upanishads, you will find that they will say that the different beings are there. God alone is the essence of all those things, and He is like the thread that runs through the garland of this existence. Tatraikastham Jagat Krishnam Pravivaktam Anekada Apashya Deva Devasya Sharire Pandavastada. When that one becomes many, when that infinite divides itself as the finite, so what happens? It is that one, it appears now as many. So essentially it is one. For example, here we have this floor, and you draw some dividing lines. Once you draw these dividing lines, it is that one which appears. Actually, there is no division. Sri Ramakrishna used to say beautifully that here is this Ganga water, and you place a stick, it's the same water, it's not divided into two. So there is actually no division, and yet there is a division. Now we Hindus, we talk on those lines that actually it is one, but it appears as many. And this appearance of one as many is Maya. We are not saying that this many is wrong. So when you put a stick to say that this side and that side of Ganga, for example, we have this famous Howrah bridge, and you say that this side of bridge and that side of bridge. Is this division true? It is, for all practical purposes. In reality, it is true. No, it is not. It is something like that when it comes to spirituality. The one is the ultimate truth. The many, that is also true, but it's relative truth. It is not the absolute truth, because it is only in appearance. So how is saying that one existence, it has divided itself as different divine beings. In Hindu religion, we have any number of divine beings. There are gods, and they say that there are 33 crore of gods. That's not the total number. There's a type of famous gods. So we don't know how many gods are there. Then there are the lesser divine, they are known as Pitris. Pitris means, M-A-N-E-S means, ancestors. So persons who have performed noble work, but not really great work, after death, they go to the heaven marked for the means. These are slightly lower than the heaven of the gods. And then we have these human beings, and in between you have Gandharvas, and there are great sages known as Siddhas, and then there are Apsaras, any number of divine beings. So is there? In that Lord's body, Arjuna is able to see this manifoldness, how that one has become many, he is seeing. In one single body, it's like, it's slightly difficult to give you an idea what Arjuna might have seen. But we can use a very crude example. Example is crude, don't take it literally, and that's of collage. If you think of a huge collage, and the collage is made, and in that collage you have different things, different pictures, and all those different pictures make one single picture. If you can think of a living collage, a collage of living beings, and living beings of different spheres, that's how the Lord appeared to Arjuna. Now it's naturally, you know, overwhelming. Arjuna is not able to maintain his balance anymore. Naturally, anyone will. The Krishna, with whom he has lived like a friend, like an elder brother, or in whatever form you might say, and that Krishna, who is the charioteer in this war, that same Krishna is the Lord. And this idea will be repeated again, again, and again in this chapter. Arjuna is overwhelmed. Tata savismaya avishto arishta roma dhananjaya pranamya shirasadevam kritanjali abhashata. Arjuna is just overwhelmed. He has horripilations of hair, like the hair of his body, they are standing on their end. And he's amazed. He's not able to maintain his normal mental tranquility. And he started making pranams, offering oblations to the Lord with folded hands. And whatever Arjuna saw at that moment is being described here. This is being described by Sanjaya to Dhritarashtra. If you might remember when we began, that Sanjaya was given a boon by the great sage Vyas that whatever happens in the war field, Sanjaya will be able to see, and he will be able to narrate that to Dhritarashtra. So Sanjaya is narrating what Arjuna saw. So Arjuna is narrating what he himself is seeing. So there are two stages of narration. Pashyami devans tava devadehe sarvans tata bhudvishe sanghan brahmanamisham kamalasanastham rishimsha sarvanuragansha divyan. O Lord, O Krishna, I am seeing in your body everything that is there in the universe, everything that is animate and inanimate, the living and the dead. And beings of different kinds and different shapes and different forms. And I'm also seeing the Creator Lord Brahma in your body, present in your body. And the famous sages like Vasishtha and all, they are also present in your body. It's amazing. Anek bahu dar vaktra netram pashyami tva sarvato ananta rupam nantam namadhyam na punasavadim pashyami vishveshwara vishwarupa. Arjuna says, I am seeing you with many arms and many stomach, many belly, many mouths, many eyes. Essentially it means to say infinite number of, you cannot say how many. And your face is everywhere. There is no direction. There is absolutely no direction where there is no face of yours. By direction, they don't mean just four directions or 10 directions or 8 directions. No. It means that every inch, every angle that you can conceive of, when you think of a 360 degree circle and you think of any number of degrees, that will be a different direction. So the Lord's face is in every direction. And O Lord of the universe, O Lord of the cosmic form, whose form is everywhere, neither I can see your beginning, nor can I see your end, nor can I see your middle. This is infinity. Infinity means that. Because normally what happens, either you see the beginning, or you see the end, or you see the middle. It says neither there is the beginning, nor there is the end, nor there is the middle. It's actually the idea of infinity is really very difficult to comprehend. And we keep telling that in physics they say that if infinity creeps in your equation, it's time for you to discard that theory. And the infinity and zero, they have such serious problems. If you divide 3 by 0, it becomes undefined or infinity. And 5 by 0 is undefined or infinity. And they being equal, zero and zero being equal. 3 into 0 is 0, 5 into 0 is 0. You divide by 0 and then it becomes 3 equal to 5. So infinity has such strange properties. So these things are not permitted. In spirituality, infinity is the fundamental truth. In this world, every time we think of infinity, we just think of very big. We think of the sky, we think of the universe, we think of this earth, we think of huge ocean. But these are all finite. Infinity means where you know that you don't know where is the middle, where is the beginning. A very crude example that we can use is a circle. You cannot say where the circle began, where the circle ends, and where exactly lies this middle of that circle. I mean circle the line. No, you cannot. Because every point is the beginning point, every point is the end point, and every point is the midpoint. Swamiji also defines soul and God like that and says that soul is infinite, whose center is in the body. And God is infinite, whose center is everywhere, circumference is everywhere. So God is someone whose center is everywhere. Me as a soul, my center is this body, but it's infinite. God is infinite, and yet His center is everywhere. It's something like that. And yet, how does He look? Kiritinam gadinam chakrinam cha tejo rashim sarvato diptimantam pashyami tvam dur niriksham samanta dipta analark dyutima prameyam. The Lord has chakra. Chakra is that famous disc in His hand with which He kills the enemies, and He has the mace, gada, and He has the divine crown, and His face is so brilliant, so bright, like fire and sun, they are all combined, and it's so difficult to look at your face. That entire thing cannot be grasped by the mind. That is how the Lord appears to Arjuna. Bright, is brilliant in every direction. You cannot say that this side is brilliant and bright and that side is not. So, O Lord, I can guess. I can just make a guess about you. Tomaksharam paramam veditabhyam tomasya vishwasya param nidhanam tom avya shashvata dharma gopta sanatanastvam purusho matomi. I can just make a guess. That's what Arjuna says. You are that Supreme Lord who is imperishable. The Lord. Lord doesn't have a beginning, Lord doesn't have an end, Lord doesn't have a middle. Akshara. So one name of Lord is Akshara. Akshara means imperishable, that can never get destroyed. You are Akshara. And Paramam Veditabhyam. You are the Supreme Knowable, one who should be known. The only, see, for example, since our childhood we have been learning lots of subjects. It says that only thing that should be known in this universe is the Lord. And tamasya vishwasya param nidhanam. You are the ultimate shelter for this universe. Tvam avyaha shashvata dharma gopta. You can never be destroyed. Because Atman is ever present, everywhere present. And Shashvata Dharma Gopta Sanatanastvam Purusho Matome says, you are the protector of the eternal religion. Lord is being described here as Tvam Avyah Shashvata Dharma Gopta Sanatanastvam Purusho Matome. Says, Sanatana Dharma, eternal religion, it never gets destroyed. Hindu religion is known as eternal religion. Now, eternal religion means the spiritual facts which are not the product of mind, which are not the product of imagination. These truths will always be there. These truths will always be there whether you believe it or not, whether you accept it or not. So, see, for example, some religion may come. In India, we have lots of sages, and initially they talk about themselves as saint. From there they become sage, and from there they become Bhagwan. So there is one of those Bhagwan, and then he started calling himself Bhagwan, and before that he was Sri, and then he became something. So some saint may claim to be God. Some religion may come up and coin a term and say that this is God. Now here, God has been described as someone who is pure consciousness and who protects the basic nature of religion. Hindu religion is not based on the words of any one single person. It is not based on the realization of any one single person. Hindu religion is all about the realization of the supreme truth. If you chance to read the Vedas, and there when they are talking about the spiritual truths, when they are talking about spirituality being the ultimate truth behind everything material, immaterial, every life force, everything, they are talking about spiritual truth. When you chance to read the Upanishads, what they are talking about is spiritual truth impersonally. There is no personality involved in it. It's not because some prophet here or some prophet there or some saint here or some saint says there, he just came up and said that I am the only truth. No, he doesn't say. Say, well, this is the truth. You go, you practice, and you yourself will realize this. This religion is protected by the Lord Himself. If God does not protect religion, it's beyond the power of just us humans to protect religion. So there is this eternal religion. God protects that. And when that eternal religion is ever in danger, God comes, He incarnates, and He protects it through various means. Sometimes He may take up sword, and sometimes He may just give a spiritual evolutionary push. In Sri Krishna's case, we find that He has been doing lots of things. He has been into fighting. He has been the policy maker. He has been into different kinds of negotiations and all. And is also giving a direct spiritual evolutionary push as with Gita. And verse number 19 onwards, we will take up in the next class. Oh, okay, thank you.